Well, welcome to the Professor and the Hack video special. Merry Christmas, everybody. I'm the Hack. I'm Hugh Riminton. And here is the Professor, PVO. G'day.
G'day, Peter. Hugh. Good to be here in person.
Mate, I've got to tell you, I'm not feeling too festive.
Why is that?
I'm going to take off the festive hat.
I think I can guess, but take us through why.
Omicron, man, Omicron. It's upon us. Brad Hazard, an aptly named politician, if ever there was one, reckons Omicron is going to be galloping through New South Wales. He's a state health minister.
Well, you were saying before, 25,000 a day, potentially.
25,000 a day cases by the end of January.
Obviously, we have to get our heads around the transition to thinking about this through ICU cases and deaths, don't we? Because when you hear 25,000 cases a day, that's nothing like anything we've experienced through the last nearly 2 years of this pandemic. Other parts of the world have, but we certainly haven't. So hopefully the vaccinations and this new variant are going to help keep things like ICU numbers and deaths down. But, boy, they're going to go up if case numbers go that high.
Because it all depends on this, doesn't it? Because we've, you know, the Prime Minister says we're stepping back, we're getting out of, government's getting out of people's lives, the borders are opening. Even Mark McGowan has peeked out from over the fortress and had a look and said, OK, then in February, then maybe we'll...
Is he going to do that now, do you think?
Oh, I don't know.
I mean,
they can't surely go back. But if the death toll goes up...
Well, and if it's not in all states yet, I mean, part of the issue here becomes that you can't unscramble an egg, doesn't it? So, you know, Queensland's borders are now open, so are Tasmania's, and as you say, WA will be arriving soon and South Australia's been there for a little while now. If the new variant, or indeed Delta for that matter, goes into these states rather than just at the numbers that it is now or higher in places like Victoria and New South Wales, then there's no point shutting down borders state to state. But if somewhere like Western Australia, who isn't, they're not planning to open until February, we know that. If this is what Brad Hazard says in New South Wales, 25,000 cases, or even frankly half that by early January, then I can't see Mark McGowan opening the borders up. That has all sorts of implications on the Federation. But either way, we're looking at potentially lockdowns. I mean, we know from other parts of the world that having... You know, high vaccination rates is no guarantee against lockdowns.
And then we've got this stuff coming out about particularly AstraZeneca, the suggestion coming in that it has lower protections against Omicron over time. We know that the AstraZeneca rollout when it came was particularly for those who were vulnerable. It was the first one that we're making available, so the older people got it. So those older Australians, naturally more vulnerable, are now with a protection before any boosters, a protection which is less effective against Omicron, that indicates to me there's a problem and the government had better be much sharper about getting these booster shots out and into arms than they were in the first go round.
That's for sure, because whilst we've got amazing vaccination rates now by global standards for the age cohorts that it's been eligible for and that we hear the reporting on, it was a slow start. It was a stroll out, not a rollout. And they'd better hope, electorally, apart from anything else, that that doesn't become the case in the coming months as we count down to the federal election, because Scott Morrison, he's looking precarious enough. We'll get to some of the ins and outs of that, no doubt. You throw in a botched booster rollout with the sort of numbers that the New South Wales State Health Minister is talking about in terms of infections, and then there is a real issue there for the federal government, as well as various state governments potentially too.
It's funny because we thought that for an end of year, it would all be historical. It would have been the rear vision mirror, as the Prime Minister likes to say, all this COVID carry-on. But let's talk about the year because, history actually happens. The sense that every year is much the same as every other. In fact, every year produces a lot of noise, but it also produces things that are historic and that change the nation. And I look back to the beginning of the year, Grace Tame being named the Australian of the Year with a background in being a voice for young victims of sexual assault. And then quickly that seemed to consume the nation, certainly the political heart of the nation, when Brittany Higgins made her allegations about being raped inside the Parliament building. How much do you think, if at all, that has changed in a deep core level the politics, the sense of where women stand inside the politics of this country?
Yeah, look, I honestly think that its medium to long-term impact may well depend on what happens at the election. And I say that because even though this shouldn't be a partisan issue and it should be a case of the awareness, particularly of the goings-on at Parliament, the more broad-based awareness around sexual assault and violence towards women. This has been bubbling for some time and it's become much more focused this year, as you mentioned, no doubt about that. But it feels a little partisan in the sense that we hear constant criticisms that the government are not getting it, if you like, that the Prime Minister in particular doesn't get it, that there isn't enough action afoot from the government in response to things like the Jenkins Review or indeed the previous Jenkins Review where they hadn't implemented, I think, 55 recommendations. They'd done maybe a handful of them and that was it. The reason I think it's relevant to the next election result is because if Scott Morrison wins, I think that there is a risk that this momentum stalls in the aftermath without an election. And there's a risk coupled with that, that this government doesn't take these issues seriously enough going forward, that it can become more lip service and less practical.
But hang on a minute, we've got a Prime Minister for women now, Maurice Payne.
Yeah, well, that's true. I remember that rhetoric. Wasn't that appalling? But do you agree with me about this? My worry would be that whatever the other reasons to elect or to throw out the Morrison government, and there's a plethora of issues in the political mix as far as the agenda goes at the election, this totemic issue that really has been the totemic issue of 2021 outside of the pandemic, frankly, the whole issue of gender rights and responsibilities when it comes to gender as well, if Scott Morrison wins, there is a risk that it becomes a moment in time that fades without adequate action to follow. There'll be some action. There will definitely be some improvement. I don't want to downplay that. But I think it would be heightened by this government paying a price for the criticisms that it hasn't done enough on this front.
It's funny because it seems to me as if there are two things going on. One is the real world issues of sexual violence against women or just general violence against women. And people, I think, fully of the view that it's past time for new measures. This falls to states to a very large degree, but nevertheless, the leadership often comes from Canberra. And then you have the separate political element of it. And you've seen from the Prime Minister now, increasingly he talks about his female candidates, made a big show of looking as if he wanted to get Gladys Berejiklian into the federal parliament and, you know, Sarah Henderson in Victoria, top of the Senate ticket. So trying to push up women. At the same time, for example, the independence movement, often funded and in some cases organised by men, or at least in part by men, but very much the independence movement is about pushing women to the fore. So there's obviously a movement that's going on underneath. The question is it an historic movement which shifts the dial forever? As you say, you've got some scepticism about that.
Well, I like to think it would do that if there was a change of government. I think then it shifts the dial. I think it becomes slower in terms of incremental change if the current government aren't removed. Because if they are removed, I think this becomes one of... Think of it this way, like look forward in the crystal ball. If Scott Morrison's re-elected, there'll be enormous frustration amongst a lot of people that feel that he's been inactive in this space. Yes, we'll have, and this is important, you mentioned it before, we'll have things like consent law reform around the state level and so forth. So there will be important changes that have happened this year. But if he is re-elected, I think there will be a frustration and a go slow on some of what the federal government needs to do as well as the symbolism.
Because he'll be able to say, well, look, you know, the people have spoken. They're happy with our pace. He'll talk up the pace that he's done.
And he'll bring other things into the mix as well. Yeah. And it'll become a crowded field, if you like. But if he loses, it's not just that I think Labor is better on this issue. I mean, we know they're better on gender in most respects for a start, even just at the first stage, they have quotas and the Liberal Party doesn't. And as a result, they've got gender balance in their parliamentary representation and the Liberal and National parties don't. But I think they're more broadly better on gender issues. I don't think that's hugely in dispute. But it's not just that. It's also the reflection that you'd see on the conservative side of politics. If they win the election, there is that attitude, Hugh, that you alluded to, that, well, we won, so we haven't done anything wrong. Our approach has been fine. It's been endorsed by the people. If they lose, though, they go into opposition. The wilderness years start for however long. That becomes a period of introspection, doesn't it? And I think that reflection that we would see moderate Liberals certainly gain a voice and make the point that we lost large chunks of the electorate. I suspect that the Australian Election Survey that gets done each election cycle by Ian McAllister and his team out of ANU, I suspect that would show that there was a gender divide in the way that the voting patterns were shown to hold up. And if it does show that, and if Morrison loses with a sizable female vote differential for the Labor Party, then I think that forces a reflective amount of change within the coalition in opposition. So I do think it's an important time. I mean, if that is the thing that you're looking to vote on, and that is what matters to you, I think at this election, that more than, for example, the economy, which we'll talk about, that the coalition wants the focus to be on, I think that is where people need to think about whether that's enough for them to change their vote, because I think it will be a dividing line on the on this particular issue.
Well, let's talk about the economy, because I like the view of history. So we do history on the run as journalists, but there is still history going underneath it. We've got an economy which has got record levels of deficit.
We're not back in black.
We're not back in black.
No.
We're not even in balance. It's a huge hole. You know, the curious fact that that's happened on the coalition's watch. However, consumer sentiment has bounced back. It's too early to say whether wages have bounced back, but there are predictions that they might. Mm. Unemployment is looking healthier. So what is the economic takeout, or the takeout regarding the economy, out of this past year, and what it means for the election year?
Well, at one level, printing money works. So, you know, the Reserve Bank printing money and underwriting the economy essentially is allowing us in a low interest rate environment to spend our way out of trouble and to spend our way towards growth, lower unemployment, all the things that the government needs, despite, you know, low immigration because of the pandemic being the kind of thing that is a huge hurdle to economic growth. So that has happened. But, you know, the idea of debt isn't concerning when rates are as low as they are, but it becomes concerning if rates start to rise. And there are predictions, not so much necessarily in 2022, but certainly by the following year, that rates will start to rise and banks might increase home loan rates irrespective of whether the Reserve Bank moves on the underlying cash rate or not. So in a sense, they can take it out of the hands of government if they do that, the banks I'm talking about. So debt is clearly not the political problem that it once was. I mean, the coalition...
Well, it's not a political problem for the coalition, but I just can't help feeling that if it was Labor delivering those same debt numbers, that is all you'd ever hear about.
Of course. I mean, we had a debt and deficit disaster, according to the coalition, when Labor were in power. And with the projections, debt at that point was a quarter of where it's predicted to head towards in the not too distant future, I might add. So debt is now something that, you know, the coalition says is just a manageable component of a AAA economy. When it was Wayne Swan that was presiding over a AAA rated economy, debt was a debt and deficit disaster. And Barnaby Joyce was talking to us about $100 lamb roasts and all the rest of it. Where does this go going forward? Well, I guess if Labor win the election, the coalition will instantly pivot and try to argue that debt's a problem again. We need to show austerity. But can they get away with that again? I don't know if they can. I think they're starting to wear thin on this argument. It was all built on the Keating years ending in 96 with the so-called Beazley black hole. He was finance minister, as you'd recall, but they held it against him because he became the opposition leader after the 96 defeat. But we were talking about single-digit billions of dollars at that point in time. Now we're talking about hundreds of billions of dollars, and we haven't had inflation to justify that differential. The difference is whether or not the mindset shifts, both for politicians and for, I guess, voters. But, you know, private debt is what bothers me. That's not often talked about in the context of politics. Private debt levels worry me, particularly with interest rates going up. Government debt, it's not ideal to where it was, but a healthy amount of government debt, as long as it's good debt in a climate of low interest rates, is actually the kind of thing that can help kick an economy along, as we're seeing with the way that the government are presenting the numbers now. They're using debt to try to fuel economic growth.
So there's a good economic argument for that. There's a very good political argument for doing that. But to go to your point, had it been Labor, they would have gone nuts. So at what point does the varnish around the coalition that seems to be impermeable, that they are the better economic managers, start to pock?
That's a really good question. I don't have the answer. I mean, I would have expected it by now, insofar as their own argument, they've just been completely hung, drawn and quartered by their own argument with where debt has gone, but they justify it through the pandemic. It wasn't good enough for Labor to justify much lower levels of debt increase during the GFC because of the global financial crisis. So there is an absolute hypocrisy here. And it's not just... And this is an important point. It's not just an hypocrisy of the conservative side of politics with the way they mount their political arguments. Voters buy into this hypocrisy because all the polls tell us that when it comes to economic management, voters believe that the coalition do it better, the Liberal Party in particular, than Labor do. Now, whether that's right or wrong is a too long a debate for this podcast. I certainly grew up watching the microeconomic reforms of the Hawke-Keating government, thinking that, you know, their finance team were pure geniuses in the way that they were reforming the Australian economy. But out the other side of that, we had a few tough moments, didn't we? We had recession, we had high interest rates. Ultimately, we had what was seen to be relatively large debt at the time. That's been held against Labor ever since, despite all the good things they did reforming the economy. I don't know if voters are ever going to, if you like, wake up to the idea that the notion of, you know, coalition good, Labor bad when it comes to economic management is just a simpleton's fallacy, frankly. I just don't know when or how that changes.
But as long as it holds, Morrison and his government have got to be in with at least an even chance at the election.
Well, I still think they're favourites. I still think they're going to win. I think they've lost favouritism, I should say, because of how consistently the polls have been where they are. But I just think as the incumbents that they're likely to scrape home on the economic mantra. But I think Labor have become the favourites because they've dominated for long enough now in the polls. They're deserved favourites. But the problem that they've got is that the Labor pathway to victory, we've talked about this before, is a whole series of goat tracks. You know, they might get there on the issue of gender. They might get there on problems with the vaccine rollout. They might get there on pandemic management issues more broadly than just the vaccine rollout. They might get there on Scott Morrison and questions about whether he's loose with the truth. There's so many of these goat tracks as pathways to victory, whereas for the coalition, they've only got one pathway to victory, and it's a very simple one-lane highway right up the guts. And it's economic management. And that's what they're going to try to pivot to. They're going to bring the budget forward. We know that. It's going to be in late March. They're going to then try to build off that with a campaign for May that sees them win a May election. That's the most likely scenario. Now, will it work for them? It's tight. It's tight for one very simple reason, Hugh. They need to win seats, pick up seats to hold a majority because of redistributions, as well as someone like Craig Kelly in the seat of Hughes moving away from the Liberal Party. Can they do that? I don't feel comfortable with this prediction. I comfortably predicted that Bill Shorten had the last election in the bag and Scott Morrison came from the clouds. This time I think Scott Morrison gets there, but I wouldn't want a gun to my head on this one, or I wouldn't want my house on the line or anything of that sort, because it is so tight at this point in time. But I just feel like a campaign's going to break the way of the incumbent. If it doesn't, though, I think we'll know a fair way out from polling day. Like if Scott Morrison doesn't have what it takes to get this coalition government a fourth term, I don't see it being a sort of last 48 or 72 hours of the campaign shift. I think it will become more abundantly obvious as the campaign rolls on, almost in the exact opposite of what happened at the last election, where Bill Shorten started with such a lead, and rather than it becoming obvious that he couldn't lose, it looked like it was getting tighter. I think that for Labor to win, they need to start sailing away as the weeks of the campaign unfold.
But if you believe that Scott Morrison can win the next election, it suggests, it implies that you think that Scott Morrison is still a net asset. In a year in which it wasn't a race on vaccines, then it became a race, the lying, all kinds of other diplomatic problems with France, just the language that he uses, which that sort of daggy dad thing, which worked very well early, but started to look a little bit like a kind of a trope as the year went on, he's still an asset.
Yeah, well, he's a comparative asset. I mean, I'm personally a fan of Anthony Albanese, and I'd love the opportunity to briefly explain why in a moment.
I think you're going to have to.
But I am a fan of Anthony Albanese, but I don't think voters are. And so I think in that comparative context, I think Scott Morrison becomes the lesser of evils and therefore becomes an electoral asset rather than liability, because he's not Albo and voters think he's better than Albo. Now, that's tightened according to the polls, but I think that will loosen through an election campaign. I think Scott Morrison will pull ahead during an election campaign. It might have been different if you'd had a starker divide, with, for example, a gender divide, tenure plebiscite, or if you had a stark generational divide, even though Scott Morrison's not that old, someone like a Jim Chalmers, for example, and a Queenslander to boot, where they need to pick up seats. But with Anthony Albanese, even though I'm a fan, and I want to explain why, I don't think voters are, and I don't see that changing. And so even though it's a close election and he could easily emerge as Prime Minister, I think in that presidential contest between the two of them, I do think that Scott Morrison becomes an electoral asset. And my 30 seconds on why I'm a fan of Albo.
Take as much time as you'd like. I want to understand this.
Apart from having watched him for a long time and just thinking that he lives and breathes what he professes to be as a politician, which I think is rarer than it should be in modern politics. And apart from the fact that he also has experience as both Leader of the House and experience as Deputy Prime Minister, albeit briefly at the end of the Rudd years. So he knows government. And I like him being in the infrastructure portfolio through the duration of the Rudd years. So I feel like the rebuild out the other side of the pandemic, the experience of being in the tent during the Rudd-Gillard years as infrastructure minister is a powerful thing. He also has a degree in economics. So even though Labor has no credibility on the economic front, according to voters with all of these published polls, Albo is a trained economist. You know, Scott Morrison's a geographer. I think he studied geography. So I'm a fan of Albo and what he represents because he's Labor left but pragmatic. He's green leaning but loathes the Greens and doesn't defer to them because he's fought them in his inner city electorate his whole career. He's a climate change advocate but a pragmatic realist who's prepared to put one of the heavy hitters of the right into the portfolio, Chris Bowen, because he knows that he has to both get action but also do it in a sustainable political way. As I say, he's got all that experience as a minister. He's got the degree qualifications and he's, if you like, virtuous with a great backstory as well. You know, the single mother growing up in housing commission, going to the Catholic school where the fees assistance was provided by the church. You know, he has such a good story. But unfortunately, for some reason, that story just doesn't seem to cut through.
But isn't that the point?
That is the point.
Admirable as he is, as a human being, he seems likeable enough from what I've seen of him that the punters don't get it.
Yeah, and that's why I'm predicting Scott Morrison wins. So that's my view on Anthony Albanese, but I just don't think it's the view that will resonate, well, now, much less at the end of a campaign which becomes highly presidential. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe, you know, when you hear it, maybe I'm not good at the sales pitch. When you hear it, I think it's compelling, but you rarely hear it like that. And, you know, voters at best are lucky to capture minutes or seconds, not hours, to have something sort of explained in detail and to immerse themselves in it. I think Albo has a lot to offer, and I have a lot of criticisms with Scott Morrison, quite frankly, not least of which is how loose he is with the truth. But I don't know that voters will see it that way, particularly mainstream voters.
I get the feeling that if Scott Morrison wins again, it'll be because despite the tumultuous couple of years that we've had with the pandemic in particular, that fundamentally Australians are cautious and change averse. They have a sense that clumsy as he is on so many points, including stumbling over the truth, getting himself into more messes than you'd think a politician, a senior politician, would be able to survive, that the thing which enables them to keep going is that he retains that middle Australia, I know this is corny, but that middle Australian sense of optimistic ordinariness, I suppose, and that people relate to that. And they fear, I've long felt this about Australia, is that Australians are not fundamentally big C conservatives, but they are big C cautious.
Yes.
They don't like change and they don't like change that they can't grasp or seeing it in advance. Hawke and Keating brought in immense amounts of change, but the times were right for it and they trusted them. But in a general sense, when there's trust in politicians is so low, I think there's an aversion to change. And I think Scott Morrison works off that than anyone.
Well, I think he does, but he works off it in the most unfortunate of ways because he recognises that Australians have an aversion to change and so he does sweet FA. Whereas John Howard, I think, as a comparative point, recognised that Australians have an aversion to change, so he presented as the risk-averse conservative who just was keeping things as they are. You know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, that kind of mantra. But behind the scenes, he didn't do as much as the Hawke Keating government. You wouldn't expect him to. He's not a progressive the way that Hawke and Keating were. But he did bring in a GST, reform IR, reform the waterfront in particular, bring in gun law reform. You know, he did a lot of things, immigration, record levels of it, even though he, if you like, seemed on the surface to be pandering to Hansenism to some extent at the time. So he, John Howard, was, if you like, the good conservative because he made people relaxed and comfortable by minimising the outward appearance of change, but actually got on with what, if you like, a right-wing liberal or conservative should do where they see reform as being important or necessary. Morrison has that same aura of doing nothing to calm the horses and to keep people at bay and relaxed and comfortable. But then that relaxed, comfortable attitude will one day put us at risk because a day of reckoning will come. Governments that don't ensure that the economy and that the nation reforms, whether it's culturally or economically, eventually a day of reckoning comes. And I think Australia for so many decades has been ahead of that day of reckoning. You know, as we almost hit it at the end of the Menzies period, bang, in came Gough Whitlam and he achieved the change that we needed. When we almost hit it at the end of the Fraser period when the macroeconomic reform had been ignored and the Canberra review had been ignored, in came Hawke and Keating and they got done what they needed to get done. When we were at risk of potentially going the other way and reform fatigue setting in, Howard presented the way he did and continued to reform behind the scenes just without all the big optics attached to it. I think the risk of a Morrison government is that a do-nothing government that makes people relaxed enough to keep voting them in because they're not scared by it will ultimately send us off a cliff like lemons at some point. And what happens then?
And what would that cliff look like? What would be the reason why we go off?
I think we fall away on our global competitiveness, for example. I think debt gets away from us as another possible option. I think that the educational system, particularly universities, but high school as well, and primary school for that matter, falls so far behind globally that we become a laggard nation in some respects. These are all the risks that present themselves. I think the health system's probably less at risk because of COVID, ironically enough, because of the attention that it has thus required. But all these are things where more could happen. Tax reform's a big one. I mean, there's nothing sexy about tax reform, but we desperately need it as overall tax reform, not as piecemeal reform. The government says, oh, we've dropped marginal tax rates, income tax rates, but that's if anything, that's exacerbating the problem to some extent between the haves and the have-nots with the way that they've done it. We need wholesale tax reform. And now, post-pandemic, we know that we need federation reform of some order because of the way that we've seen the dysfunction of the federation present itself during the pandemic. So Morrison, I don't think he even understands all of that, much less knows what to do, much less has the political oomph to do it. And even with him out of the way, I don't know who else does either in the coalition.
Well, do you think the Labor Party has tax reform?
Yeah, I do. But again, it depends on how they win. I mean,
and how brave they are, surely.
Yeah, and the other thing is, once upon a time in politics, you used to be able to win elections from opposition with minimal info because you're not in government. That I was always fine about that. When you're in opposition, you don't have access to departments, to large teams of advisors. You win on ideas and concepts, and then you go about filling in the details once you have the apparatus of government at your disposal. That used to be acceptable, which allowed you to sort of say little. You weren't so much small target, but you were light on detail because inevitably you have to be. But then you'd get into government and then you'd start the heavy lifting. And that's what, for example, Hawke and Keating did with the tax summit. And they implemented some of it. They didn't implement other parts of it. These days, in opposition, you get cornered partly by the media. There's that gotcha mentality of what are you going to rule in and rule out? And you're doing it, flying largely blind without access to departments. So then when you get into government, if you try to do things that you didn't pledge in opposition, then you get accused of breaking promises. If you only do what you pledged in opposition, even if it's big picture, it's pretty badly constructed because you don't have access to the departments yet. So, you know, that is a problem with the way that the media reports politics. It's a problem with the way that the public interprets it. And I think that's one of the things that culturally needs to shift. Does it shift in time for this incoming Labor government? If they win, my hope would be that there's enough of them left there, and this is the important point, my hope would be that if they win, there's enough senior figures who were there to watch it get botched during the Rudd-Gillard period to then get it right during this government's tenure if they win. A little bit like the few ministers that were there and senior players, because Hawke wasn't in Parliament yet, but he was a senior player in the union movement, who were there and watched the great ideas, if you're a social progressive, that Whitlam put forward, but implementation was botched. They were then there to take over, you know, 7 years later after Malcolm Fraser lost, and get it right.
Much more disciplined.
Yeah. Mm.
So what do you think are going to be the scare campaigns we should watch out for, the dead cats that are going to get thrown around on both sides? Of course, Labor famously had its Medi-Scare campaign a few years back. Mm. What are they going to look like? $100 lamb roasts aren't going to cut it anymore. And even the attack on Labor's position on carbon pricing or carbon emissions is made more difficult by the fact that most of business and industry backs them.
Yeah, that's one of the ironies, isn't it? I mean, the Business Council, the National Farmers Federation, right across the spectrum, Labor's side of politics on how they're approaching emissions gets their backing, not the coalitions. I don't see that the scare campaign on that front necessarily working.
Is it on boats? There's going to be a scare campaign, we know. That's
I think it's just going to be generic on the economy. I think it's going to be this idea of don't risk the recovery out the other side of the pandemic by electing Labor. And I know there's not much meat on the bones of that, but that, coupled with what I mentioned about the way Albo's perceived versus Morrison, even though I don't agree, and that coupled with the way that Labor more broadly are perceived as economic managers, fairly or unfairly, versus the coalition, I think just that kind of no meat on the bones messaging, don't risk Labor when it comes to economic recovery post-pandemic, I think that's the scare campaign that the coalition run. I don't know that I'd call Labor's a scare campaign, but I mean, in a sense, they run a scare campaign on the environment, whether it cuts through or not, by saying that we need to act more swiftly than what the government are offering. Their stronger campaign, I think, will actually be to target Morrison, which is interesting, isn't it? If you think that Albo is weaker than Morrison in the ways that I've mentioned, fairly or unfairly, watching Labor then mount a serious campaign that targets Morrison in that presidential-style contest as being loose with the truth, not someone you can trust, not someone you should therefore entrust the nation to, that is quite full frontal as an attack to where the coalition thinks its strength is. They think their strength is a one-on-one contest between Albo and Morrison, yet Labor are prepared to go one-on-one. So it becomes a slugfest.
How do they do it, though? So do they do it through conventional media? Do they do it through social media campaigns, through wit? We've seen far too little wit in our political landscape for quite a while. So, you know, how do you frame your enemy in ways that actually resonate with the audience?
Well, I think that's Labor's problem here, is I think that the way that they're framing it will be potentially preaching to the converted. You know, whether it's social media or inner sanctums of one form or another, I could easily see the way that they're framing it working on all those fronts, but they're preaching to the converted. Whereas when you're talking about targeted marginal seats, outer metropolitan seats, usually swinging voters in particular within those outer metropolitan marginal seats, you know, you're really sort of sifting down to the most important, electorally speaking, components of the electorate. And I think that messaging Labor may be found wanting on the sort of messaging that we're talking about, whereas the coalition's messaging around don't risk pandemic recovery by giving it to Labor, I think that messaging, when it's narrowed to those voting cohorts, is very powerful and more powerful.
The impression you get is that Scott Morrison, the Liberal Party in general, sees male tradies as the key to the election.
Well, and we see that just for starters with, you know, in the mid-financial year, so end of calendar year budget update, you know, where we're going to see all sorts of detail. But one of the things that will reveal, and, you know, people will be watching this after it's been revealed, as I understand it, is an increase in spending on housing, for example, you know, all about the money that they've been pumping into building and renovations and tradespeople. Very male-dominated and very very outer metropolitan, marginal seat focused as well, and we're going to see a lot more data on that front showing an uptick because of their policies, which goes to pork barreling, I guess.
Let's talk about pork barreling. Plenty of evidence that this government has taken it to heroic levels.
Yeah.
What's your view of it in general? Geoffrey Watson, who is a former senior, well, he's a senior counsel, but formerly counsel to the New South Wales ICAC, said, stop calling it pork barreling. It is the misuse of public money. It's been described as corruption by others, Zali Stegel among her among others. Does the public perceive it as corruption? Is the pork barrelling that we've seen reported from this government, car park rorts, so many of the rorts, something that which will get up and damage the coalition?
I don't think so. Again, I think what it does is preach to the converted, people who are already critical of the government on all manner of issues. They add this to the list. I think when you get back to those targeted marginal seats, they're the ones getting the money. And so they tend to think this isn't too bad, that they're getting, you know, extra car parks or bridges and overpasses that they might need, whatever it might be. So I tend to think, you know, sports facilities for local community sports, for example, through grants, all of that, I think, helps the coalition. Now, to the bigger question, the wider question of whether it pork barrelling constitutes corruption or misuse of public money, my natural feeling is absolutely. You know, I mean, I have a profound issue with this. I'm just trying to work out what's the better way to go, because I do believe in democracy and I do therefore believe in politicians having the say on how money gets spent. And so if you're elected pledging to do something, that you're allowed to then do it. But having said all of that, you like to think that it's not a winner-takes-all environment in elections. Well, then we become like Singapore, don't we? If you vote against the government of the day, your electorate gets nothing so that you come back at the following election. That's not democracy either.
But it's not democracy to say that voter A in safe seat for either side here has less access to the largesse of the nation than the person who, through accidental distribution policies of the Electoral Commission, happens to live in a marginal seat, in which case all kinds of money gets flooded at them, which has come from the other person's
taxes. But how do you fix it, Hugh? This is the problem I've got. Like, on the one hand, like, don't get me wrong, for God's sake, don't anyone think that I'm defending, you know, pork barrelling and misuse of money. I consider it a misuse. I've written so much about this for so long. But I guess what I'm wondering is, beyond what we already do, where you have auditor general reports and you expose it, right, and you point out that public servants are saying money should go to these worthy projects, but guess what? The elected government of the day sent it over here to these marginal seats. How do you change that?
Sure,
because they're the elected people who – I prefer elected people to decide where the money goes because they're more accountable than bureaucrats. But the problem is there used to be a limit. You know, like, there used to be a level of respect for the system amongst politicians where you'd have elements of pork barrelling, but they wouldn't go too far. Now it's just become
flagrantly ridiculous.
And so what I'm trying to get my head around is, do we damage the concept of accountability through democratic means by taking away these powers from the politicians and giving them to independent bureaucratic decision makers? I don't like that. But we're sort of at the point where we have
to.
Otherwise they're just
misusing it so much. It has to cost politicians, otherwise they keep doing it. And for the very good point.
But I loathe that, you know. I naturally loathe it, but I think you're right. I think I don't see an alternative.
Let's look at non-major parties. There's this huge amount of publicity being generated about the independents who are targeting Liberal seats or coalition seats. Then you've got the Craig Kelly, Clive Palmer-funded types of approaches. You've still got those other outsider parties, if you like, Pauline Hanson's One Nation, Catter and others that are floating around. How significant do you think they'll be in the next parliament?
Yeah, it's a good question. I tend to think that if Scott Morrison is going to lose the election, then he loses by enough of a margin that Labor can form government on its own, or if it needs some crossbench support, the locked-in crossbenchers of Wilkie from Tasmania and Adam Bandt as the Green out of Melbourne, they would fall maybe too short, and then they pick them up and they've got their majority. So in other words, if it's going to be a change of government, I tend to think that the move will be on sufficiently that cobbling together crossbench support beyond those two won't matter to Labor. But that doesn't mean that the independents are irrelevant. Because apart from anything else, whether they win or lose, all these, it's particularly a group of female independents running against moderate Liberals in, you know, more inner city Liberal held seats, right? Where they feel like climate change and gender issues aren't being adequately addressed, which they're right about. They could all lose and still have a profound impact, because the amount of money that they cost the Liberal Party to hold what are meant to be otherwise safe seats, that's money that's not getting spent on marginal seats, and the distraction that they can cause in terms of media coverage, such that they're taking away what Scott Morrison wants the focus to be on, which is issues around outer metropolitan seats, marginal seats that he has to try to either hold or pick up. So even if all of these independents lose, and, you know, it's too early to make a prediction, but I think that's more likely than not that they all lose. You know, I think
there's other than Steggall, presumably.
Oh no, I'm not including the incumbents. Yeah, not including the incumbents. So I think Helen Haynes in Indi, and Rebecca Sharkey in Mayo in South Australia, and certainly Zali Steggall as well in Warringah, without a Gladys style candidate, notwithstanding her issues, I think they all are retained. But the extra ones, you know, picking up the seat of Wentworth, picking up North Sydney, picking up McKellar, Kooyong, Goldstein, I don't see that happening. I think they're all more, or indeed now Boothby as well, where there's a candidate running. Across all of those seats, I think they're more likely to lose than win. They might get one, but I think they're more likely to lose than win, because in those sort of seats, you tend to hit granite if you're trying to take out a sitting member who's a Liberal. They're safe Liberal seats. They don't usually lose them. And they're all moderates who they're running against too. They might be ineffective moderates not getting changed to what the Liberal Party has become.
But they've been forced into a higher level of effectiveness than they otherwise would be.
That is true.
Because they're being, for the first time, they're copping focus. 100%. Whereas previously you held these seats like North Sydney or Wentworth or Kooyong, and, you know, you're going to get elected no matter what you did. Whereas now you have to speak up for values that previously you didn't.
And that can also hurt Scott Morrison in those outer metropolitan marginal seats by mixing the messaging of where he wants the focus to be. So there's lots of ways without winning that this collection of independents can still influence the election. But the only thing I'd say is one of the reasons I'm down on their capacity to actually win the seats, you know, and they hit, as I call it, the granite. They can get to 47 or 48% of the two-party vote, but then they don't quite get there with what extra they need. You need a particular set of circumstances to get that extra little way. And the three examples where that didn't happen, where that did happen, which are quite different to all of these seats that we've outlined, are now in play with the independent candidates running this time. I mean, in Warringah, you had Tony Abbott. You know, he's no moderate. He was on the nose. His own electorate, his own party wanted him out. Zali Steggall gets in. In Indi, it's now Helen Haynes, but it was Kathy McGowan before her, and that was against Sophie Mirabella.
Who was loathed. And I think
loathed, hard right, all the rest of it.
And I think that counts an enormous amount. The politician that you're standing against as an independent can't just simply be a long-time server or not interesting. They have to be actually actively
offensive.
Loathed.
Yep. And then in Mayo, it was Jamie Briggs, who was a star on the rise, touted as a future prime minister Until a bad night in Hong Kong, all sorts of untoward allegations against him. He was kicked out of the ministry and then ultimately lost the seat off the back of that to a former staffer of his who alleged that he wasn't a great boss. And she's now, of course, the member for Mayo, Rebecca Sharkey. So those three seats, particular circumstances with loathed members. And I don't see that with Dave Sharma in Wentworth. I don't see it with Tim Wilson in Goldstein. I don't see it with Josh Frydenberg even though he's near the centre of power in Kooyong. Trent Zimmerman, Jason Falinski, they're all moderates. To the letter. Boothby might be interesting, but then I think that the candidate, Joe Dwyer, is more extreme of the left, if you like, than some of these other women running who you could argue are smaller Liberals. So that probably takes her out in the seat of Boothby anyways, irrespective of if the Liberal Party picked the wrong candidate. So, yeah, they will be a distraction for Scott Morrison. They'll eat up media time, they'll chew up dollars, and they'll force him to answer positioning by those moderates where they might have otherwise been voiceless, but I don't know that they will get elected so much as have an impact.
And what about Clive Palmer's money? He didn't win seats last time, but he had a big influence on the outcome.
Same sort of thing, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. So does Craig Kelly get in? You've got a Melbourne Cup field for his electorate of Hughes. Again, independents sitting up there. You've got Liberals. You know, it's one of those strange mixed-up seats. So Kelly could come through, but there's a very good chance that he won't.
I'm surprised that he didn't move to the Senate, actually, although I guess New South Wales is a hard Senate race for a United Australia Party person, even with a large amount of donation support because it's such a large state. It's not like running for the Senate in Tasmania, for example, where Jackie Lambie can successfully do so and was initially successfully elected for the United Australia Party. That feels like a long time ago now, doesn't it? But, yes, I... I would expect it to be very difficult for Craig Kelly to get re-elected in the seat of Hughes. He'll have an impact on which of the major parties gets re-elected. And more broadly, I mean, the United Australia Party, it's the dollars that it throws around that can have the impact. A risk for Scott Morrison, though, on that front is that the tens of millions that Clive Palmer put into the mix at the last election were very targeting of Bill Shorten and his inappropriateness to be Prime Minister. This time, from what little I've seen so far, it looks like the targeting from United Australia Party is all about how bad the Morrison government is rather than about how bad the opposition is.
It's a lot about freedom.
Yeah.
So he's got onto that sort of bandwagon.
But that's the risk, though, isn't it? Because before it was all, don't vote for Bill Shorten, he's a disgrace. So whilst these votes might have bled away from both major parties, that was sending preferences the way of the coalition. This time, when the message from Clive Palmer's party is freedom and the Morrison government have been terrible on this front, that could bleed preferences back Labor's way, or at least not bleed them as badly against Labor as happened in 2019.
That's interesting insight. The other one you mentioned, Adam Bandt of the Greens, being a reliable vote if it winds up being a hung parliament, and Albanese has got the lead role to form government. But we've heard from Adam Bandt that he's urged people to vote for a minority government so that the Greens can have influence over climate policy, and have plainly indicated that the price, if Labor turns to the Greens, is that they're going to have to up their ante on emissions policy.
They're not going to do that, though. I mean, this is one of the things we talked about.
They've done it before.
They're not going to do it again. We talked about scare campaigns. I actually think one of the more likely attempts at a scare campaign that Morrison will go down, he's already started to some extent, is this idea of tethering Labor to the Greens. You know, you elect Labor, you'll get Greens policies. Now, at one level, that could work with sections of the electorate because of the history of the Labor Party going into alliance between Julia Gillard and Bob Brown with the Greens after the 2010 minority Labor government. But Albanese was opposed to that at the time. Part of what I was talking about before, Albanese has been fighting Greens in his backyard, in his seat in New South Wales's inner city, for a long time now. And he knows that negotiating with the Greens and being seen to be in bed, if you will, with the Greens is poison for Labor when it comes to attracting centre votes. So, yes, he will take Green preferences. He'll do deals for Green preferences. And, yes, he will have his policies, and he will dare Adam Bandt and the Greens to vote against Labor policy. If you are so concerned by our policy, go right over there and vote for Scott Morrison. Greens are never doing that.
Sit on the same side of the room as...
He will not make the mistake that Julia Gillard did. Julia Gillard, after the 2010 election, was trying to, if you remember, she was trying to build momentum towards getting that majority because she needed to get Oakeshott and Windsor over the line. So she grandly announced that Wilkie has come on board. She grandly announced that Adam Bandt has come on board for the Greens, and she grandly announced an alliance with the Greens, and she's trying to build momentum, and she got there. She ended up getting Oakeshott and Windsor on board, but she did enormous damage to the Labor brand in terms of a scare campaign and allowing Tony Abbott to really tether the Greens and Labor and cause political problems for them. Albanese won't let that happen, even if he's sitting there needing to run around with a begging bowl for support as a minority Labor government. He will not do a deal with the Greens other than to say, vote for us or vote for Scott Morrison, and that would be political poison to the Greens. And I mean, he has said as much publicly as well as privately. I can't see him going down that path. But it doesn't mean that there won't be a scare campaign.
On the subject of scare campaigns, I'm not sure if this is necessarily going to be a scare campaign, but... Peter Dutton is the defence minister. He loves trying to inject a little bit of khaki into the blue versus red. And he's spoken openly in the National Press Club and in other forums about China, particularly with regard to the potential for war with Taiwan. Do you see a ramping up of rhetoric about national security threats between now and a May election?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I'd be just as interested to get your thoughts on this. This is much more in your theatre of expertise than mine. My initial view is yes, I think that they will try it the same way that Peter Reith tried to do some of that when he was defence minister in the countdown to the 2001 election. Much more successful times for that, I think, politically speaking, for the coalition then than now. But I think Dutton has done some of that already with his rhetoric, and I think he'll do more of it. And, of course, Reith was on the way out in 01, whereas Dutton very much has ambitions to lead one day. So that lends itself to him wanting to be a success with that strategy.
Do you see risks for Dutton? Can he overplay that card to the degree that it looks as if it's just purely a sabre-rattling at the risk of our position in the world to try to muster up sort of defence conservatives to the barricades?
I think it's a risk, but I kind of go back to that idea of, if we're talking about pure electoral politics, I think it cements views about the risk of the coalition in the eyes of people who are not there target audience, electorally speaking, when it comes to using national security rhetoric to win votes. So it's a risk amongst the educated elites who are professionals in this space, certainly, but I don't know that then translates to voting cohorts that the messaging's aimed at. What do you think?
Well, I think there's definitely reasons to be concerned about China's purposes towards Taiwan. Whether that plays out certainly between now and May, you'd think probably unlikely, more in a span of a few years, maybe not a great number of years. I think much might depend on the US election result. If a Trump-like figure or Trump himself was to be returned, then that will certainly encourage China. But on the Dutton versus Frydenberg front,
yeah, that's interesting.
Whether Morrison wins, and certainly if he loses, who wins between, you know, how does that position, how does it play out?
Well, if Morrison is re-elected as Prime Minister, I'll make this prediction. I actually think he will leave during that term, 18 months, 2 years in. I know that is not common. Menzies left off his own bat
17 years in.
17 years into his Prime Ministership, and it was his second stint as Prime Minister. And the only person I think who left on their own terms before that, we're literally going back, well, certainly pre-war, but I think we're going back to the early 1930s. Now, even earlier than that, actually, I think we're going back to just after Federation. So the point is, it's only happened, as I understand it, twice.
Yeah, you see, wouldn't there be the sort of semi-accidental Prime Minister, Scott Morrison? You get to a certain point, say he wins. There's a lot of sort of inbuilt into the premises here. But say he wins, you start to think, I could be as great as Howard.
Oh yeah, and you start to believe your own bullshit. Let's call it what it is.
Well,
I mean, he probably already does. But if he wins, the risk for him is the same risk that Howard fell to, which is that you start to believe your own BS and you keep going and think that you can't be beat. And then eventually when you realise that you can be beat, it's too late.
Yeah, but that's 11 years in. And Howard in retirement seems a very content man.
But Scott Morrison, that's true, and he lost his seat, right, but he's still content. But Howard got lucky in the sense that when he lost, the Liberal Party could have fallen apart and looked like it was about to fall apart. But then Labor fell apart in government, the Liberals got back, and Howard, comparative to everybody post-Howard, looked like a pretty stable figure as a long-term stable Prime Minister, and he couldn't be held to account for staying too long and therefore damaging the Liberal Party, because they got back pretty quickly after 6 years anyway. So a bit unique, I think. The reason I think Scott Morrison, if he wins, will leave off his own bat, he loves to win and he hates to lose, you know, and he's so damn political. And I could imagine him sitting there and making, and he's a former state director, so he thinks about the numbers even more than someone like Howard did. I could imagine Scott Morrison sitting there and saying, you know what? Two wins, the first of which was unexpected, the second of which was post me steering the nation through the pandemic, not the longest serving Liberal Prime Minister, not even close, but boy, the first Prime Minister since Howard to serve a full term and then also get re-elected out the other side of it. I'm leaving on my own terms rather than risking defeat. I could see him wanting that aura. He then ends up being hailed as sort of Menzies, Howard and Morrison. A lot of people are going to be, you know, losing their Weet-Bix thinking about this, but he would be seen as one of those three, as the great Liberal leaders, if he left on his own terms. But if he went to an election and lost, I think that changes, because then it becomes all the do-nothing elements of him, and the failure takes over as well, without the longevity, whereas Howard has the longevity, Morrison doesn't. But maybe he gets caught up and thinks he can't lose.
If there's even a whiff that he might be thinking of leaving, the number counting between a Dutton camp and a Frydenberg camp, the moment he might get the whiff of...
But there won't be a whiff, Hugh. There won't be a whiff. Because he'll just... Because who thinks somebody, other than me, who thinks somebody is going to leave of their own volition as Prime Minister in what is only their second full term in power? Because he only took over 8 months before the last election. It's almost unheard of. The reason I think he'll do that is because I think he'll see the writing on the wall with where his own popularity might be going. He'll see that Labor are going to be better with the next generation of leadership that takes over. And I think he'll just worry that he took over a long-term government. I mean, this is the government going for a fourth term, even though he's only going for his second full term as Prime Minister. I just think he'll be calculating and he'll want to go out a winner, and it will drive the Twitterati nuts if he gets to do that. It'll drive me nuts, quite frankly. But I think that's what's going to happen. And I think that if he wins the election. Now, what happens then between Dutton and Frydenberg? Who knows? But it will take them both by surprise. They'll both be working ferociously behind the scenes to try to garner support.
I just get a feeling that Peter Dutton's not a man who gets taken by surprise.
Well, that's what I was saying. Like, I think he'll be planning for it, although I don't think either Josh Frydenberg or Peter Dutton think what I think on this. I don't think they expect Scott Morrison to leave of his own accord. Here's a counter-argument to my position on this. I do think this is what he'll do if he wins. One of the things that's interesting, though, is he still has to earn a crust when he leaves. He'll be mid-50s.
Yep.
He may not even be 55 by then. He's early 50s at the moment. And there's no parliamentary pension in the way that there was once upon a time. You know, Latham ended that gravy train at the 2004 election when Howard answered him and wiped them out. So Scott Morrison was elected post-2004 under the new parliamentary pension scheme, which means, sure, he makes his $500,000 plus as Prime Minister, but he doesn't then get three quarters of that salary for the rest of his life, like all previous ex-Prime Ministers other than Malcolm Turnbull. He doesn't count because he's worth hundreds of millions. So he will be essentially, notwithstanding Turnbull, the first Prime Minister, whenever he loses, whether he leaves of his own accord or loses at the election, he'll be the first Australian Prime Minister to go out of office without a generous parliamentary super scheme that allows him to sit back and do nothing for the rest of his life. If that's his fate in his early 50s, he'll still have to go out and earn a crust. He's got young kids. That might factor on. It sounds silly to say
judgment. Absolutely. And, you know, Kevin Rudd, who had a wealthy wife, wasn't short of a quid himself, had ambitions to become Secretary General of the United Nations. You can't see that happening there. So what is going to be the surprise? Give me your other random thought for the next 12 months. Let me give you a random thought while you think about that. So I've got these cups up here. This is the Biden cup, and this is the Trump cup from 2020. It's one of the great privileges of reporting U.S. presidential elections. You're never sure.
He's got to put a 2024 on there.
Of cheap Chinese-designed crockery. So at the end of the coming year, 2022, there are the midterm elections in the United States, which happen obviously 2 years after the presidential election. And this is going to be the clearest indication we're going to have yet where Trump is going to be setting himself up for the 2024 election. He is entitled to run. He was impeached but never convicted. He's only had one term. The signs and the signals are that unless his health collapses, he wants to return for redemption in 2024. So if there's one thing to watch for next year, as well as our own election, it is a midterm election in the United States in November, because if you see a strong field of Trump-backed candidates into congressional and Senate seats and Biden looks immensely under pressure, then it's a lay-down mazir that Trump, barring a heart attack or similar, will be running again in 24. And who knows, maybe winning.
I hate to agree with you on this, but that is also my fear/assumed most likely scenario. You know, I mean, there's so many variables that can happen, but I tend to think that if you had to pick one of those many variables, the most likely is Trump running and winning in 2024, certainly the Republican nomination and potentially the presidency, therefore, in the aftermath as well. Now, that's not to say that you can say it's the most likely of the various scenarios, but it's still a low percentage because there are so many variables. It's not 50% plus one here. But, you know, if Trump as you say, health holding up and all the rest of it, if Trump runs under the nature of their primary system in the US, it's hard to see him getting beat by any other Republican in the primary process. And once he's elected as the Republican candidate, therefore, that's why you've got to step your way through this, don't you? Once he's then elected as the Republican candidate, if the Democrats are as damaged then as they are right now, you know, whether it's Harris as VP running at the time, although there's suggestions that she, you know, wouldn't even necessarily get endorsed.
I don't believe she'll ever be president of the United States.
There you go. I tend to agree.
And I think Biden is unlikely. They might try and wheel him out again as being the best hope against Trump, but I think he's looking damaged. And then the Democrats are a house that was held together by a loathing of Trump and only just held together with sticky tape by a loathing for Trump. And with Biden as the sort of the central character, the man who could sort of be friends with more than anyone else, he got the nomination and onto the presidency. But if he is failing, and he certainly seems to be, his health, his energies, no great policy successes, then the Democrats are going to struggle like hell to find a candidate that brings them all together against another insurgency from Trump.
Yep, I depressingly agree.
Mm. There you go. So you've picked the election for next year?
Well, I sort of feel like I can't lose predicting a Scott Morrison win, because if he wins, he can't bag me for picking it wrong like he did last time, and I can say I told you so. If he loses, well, he loses. I've said what I think about Anthony Albanese as an alternative prime minister. I think he'd surprise people on the upside. So happy to be wrong if Albo finds a way to win. Happy to be right if Morrison wins. So
here you go. Well, here's to festivities, old son.
Yep, back in black in 2060.
Happy New Year. Ah, that Polish vodka is the stuff. It's the bomb.